Yeah, thank you very much. I don't need a microphone, do I?
No.
Okay. Thank you to everybody who's still here after all this tiring week. And I suggest that everybody who made it up to now, now thank the organizers who made it all possible. Who are amazingly still here, at least one of them, probably the most important one. And then, of course, my congratulations to Kenji, great congratulations. And in retrospect, I should speak about, probably, I should have chosen some topic about, you know, quantum skin rod operations, topological motion, and all self-characteristic piece stuff, which I've been doing for the last, I don't know, 10 years or more. But it's not like that. So what I'm going to talk is about, is a very, I mean, it's purely characteristic zero. It's actually a very small thing. I'm not even sure it'll take a whole hour. We'll see. It's some kind of joint work of progress with Ludmill, Kanat, and Spain. So the title is Scalar Metrics and Hodge Theory, and it's basically an exercise to go over the following, roughly speaking. So goal is logical. Yeah. So assume we have some TG algebra, TG category, even a small TG category A or C. Sometimes we know that given such a thing, we can consider modelized spaces of objects. Here, in some senses. For example, there is the toy in Marquia model derived stack of all objects. And sometimes, at least partially, it has a Keller metric. So it's a complex manifold in some very generalized sense, but still a complex manifold. Sometimes it has a Keller metric. So the question is there a structure purely on A that produces those metrics? That produces metrics on various modeling spaces. Well, I can be brave and just say, like, metric on the whole. Marquia modelized that. Perfect complexes. But this is probably too strong, because so I should qualify this immediately, because it's not even clear what's a good notion of a Keller metric on say, Artin stack. The issue is, I mean, you have stabilizers. If your stabilizer will point as a reductive group, then Keller metric should give you a maximal compact subgroup. But if it's not reductive, you still want probably a maximal compact subgroup, because that's the intuitive notion of a metric. Whereas if you just do the naive thing, it will give you some kind of real structure which where the real group will be bigger. And so to me, it's not clear what is the correct notion of a metric, of a Keller metric on a stack, which, what should we work for? So in practice, or rather, I want to be local about it. So if you have some perfect complex, we can consider the deformation space of it. And I want to take objects which are kind of stable in some sense. Or stable enough. Okay. Now, there is, of course, a prototype for all of this. I mean, these things come up quite a lot. For example, in the study of stability conditions, when you have notion of stability condition, you have notion of stable object, and there, indeed, you expect a parametric, and this has been constructed in many examples. More or less by hand, I don't know. I don't know what's the general setup there. But there's a very clear prototype for the whole thing, which is just vector bundles on, say, even curves. So take a complex curve. Well, compact. And take a stable vector 1, stable in the usual sense. Stable vector 1. Then we have at least an infinitesimal and have a very clear deformation space. It's unobstructed under this consideration. And it carries a Weyl-Peterson metric. And the definition, questions? Okay. And the definition is, just let me remind, it's very straightforward. So let M be the deformation space, then the tangent space at our point, distinguished point given by E, is of course naturally identified with the first cohomology of X of coefficients in the domorphisms. Since E is stable, you can choose a Young-Mills metric on it, so choose metric of E. This is something whose curvature is not quite zero, but it's proportional to the identity endomorphism. But then, and the coefficient is of course the first term class. So this thing has no term class, so this then carries a flat. Here you also have a metric and the connection is flat. That connection, that interconnection non-blob, and so basically this H1 here can be now considered as H01 with respect to this non-blob. Endomorphisms, but we also now have H10, we have the complex conjugation, and then the metric is just taken, you know, if you have two classes, alpha and beta, and then the metric applied to those is just the integral over X, trace alpha, which beta conjugate. So this is a nice definition. One thing which is completely non-clear from this definition is why is this a Keller metric? So why is omega closed? So the kind of standard additional answer to this has been given by in the early 1980s. And what he did, he constructed actually a Keller potential for this. So it admits a Keller potential. That is a function such that omega is dd bar of this function, it's automatically then closed. And there is a, well, reasonably explicit, well, kind of explicit form of the potential in terms of some kind of generalized regularized determinants. Determinants of the of the bar kind. So this is supposed to be a very well-established thing, and it's in the literature, although when I started actually looking at what is in the literature, it's slightly less clear than one would like it to be, but anyway, it's there. But to me, the problem is that it's really not clear what's the correct level of generality for this, because okay, it exists in the situation, and maybe there are versions for Nexus higher dimensional. But if you just have a TGK category, I mean, this is something which acts on an infinite dimensional, you know, bundle of infinite sections. Where do you get such a thing in the general context? So there is another answer, which is also very old, which I think is better in the sense that it can be generalized. So I think it's due to Bellin, but I actually learned that at a lecture from Carlos, actually, a long time ago, again, like 25 years ago. So he's not here anymore, so I can barely just put his name there. He probably would object. And then the explanation for that is the following. So, I mean, we need some way to get a kind of potential. So what you use Hodge theory. So I said that this is the tangent space, but there is also the cohomology algebra of coefficients of endomorphism. It's an abelian algebra, it controls deformations. But since the thing is flat, you can also consider like the Ramp cohomology with respect to delta, which is roughly speaking twice as large. So we have a DG algebra. Well, let me note it like this. A, which I think is standard notation for forms like in Griffiths-Harris. But all forms, I mean, not just holomorphic or zero n, but all forms. It has a map given by this integration. Some kind of trace thing. You can also consider it as a DGV algebra. Just forget the multiplication, just leave the commutator. And then it's abelian. An abelian formal DGV algebra. But it also carries a Hodge structure. So it's actually an algebra and then a posteriori algebra in the category of mixed Hodge structures. And as such, is highly non-formal. But not formal. It's an algebra in the category of mixed Hodge structures. And as a rough kind of explanation of what could measure this non-formality, let's look at what possible mass separations you could have. I mean, it's not true that if messy products vanish, the algebra is formal, but the other way around is certainly true. So it's like first indication of what is true and what is not. So here, let me just look at H1 here. I mean, the bracket is really zero, and all the usual mass separations of course zero, but what you get some new n, which sit not in Holmes. So normally mass operation is a Holm from a symmetric power to the algebra itself. Here it will be first x in the category of mixed Hodge structure. From symmetric power of this H1, to H1 there. So in principle, if you look at the whole mass, I think there should be some map in the derived category of mixed Hodge structure, which has This has homological dimension 1, so it has a home term and the first x term. And the home term is obviously just trivial. But the first x term could be highly non-trivial. All these groups are absolutely non-zero, and the idea is that these things give you a color potential. So, then, so this integration gives you omega by the same formula, more or less. But omega, at least at this point in the deformation space, is just a leading term, and then they get also the color potential. I mean, you would want to compare the two constructions, but in a sense, there is no question here, because, I mean, the metric is still the same. The metric is this one. These are just two different explanations of why it is closed, but that's a property of the structure, so in a sense, the whole story is completely empty. But still, I think it could be instructive to really look at it and see how the actual higher terms and the kind of potentials are related. And what I want to explain today is that there is a way to, so this is rather abstract homological algebra, but there is a way to make a very concrete formula for this guy.
Can you explain why this higher
mu
n gives Keller potential?
Exactly. That's the,
how do you explain that?
Both. I will explain how this gives higher Keller potential and how to actually write a formula for it. Yeah. I mean, numerically, if you look at it, so these x's, and it's not a difficult prediction. Trust me, that these are more or less always one-dimensional, meaning that they are the same size, it just comes from this guy to this guy. And then this is, roughly speaking, the same size as not the color potential, but its first derivative. So you choose alpha, such that d bar of alpha is omega, and then these are more or less coefficients for alpha. But this is a very more or less thing. They just have, I mean, kind of graded dimensions on the same. But there is a way to see it much more precisely, and this is what I'm going to do. There are different ways to work with this stuff. But so you can probably do it directly using the usual definition, I mean, the original definition of Hodge structures using filtration and so on. At least for me, psychologically, it's much easier to go geometric about it and consider interpretation of Hodge structures in terms of twister lines. So, to see this explicitly. Use geometric interpretation. Know it, but let me remind you how it works. So basically, you interpret these things as some bundles living on P1. So consider P1. For those who know, this is a twister line. For those who don't, it's just P1. In principle, it's CP1, but I also want to consider it as a real manifold, but with a non-standard real structure, which has no fixed points. So this is a sphere, there is an antipodal involution, it's anti-holomorphic, gives you real structure, but no real points. So antipodal real structure. And then you also get an action of the multiplicative group here, GM action. Well, this is C star, which fixes 0 and infinity, but it also carries the real structure in this compensation. Now, if you want to study things like bundles or sheaves on P1, you can of course glue them out of, you can cover it by two charts, and the most natural charts are just A1, which is everything minus infinity. And then you can do the complex conjugate thing. P1 minus 0. And then there is the intersection, which is GM. 4P1 minus both 0 and infinity. And then the proposition is the following. So proposition. The category R mixed Hodge structures is equivalent. Now this almost certainly been, although I don't know where it is. To the following. So vector bundle on P1, real with respect to this real structure and GM equivalent. Then an increasing filtration on this guy respecting everything. And there's a condition. And the condition is that ith associated rate quotient of E with respect to W is a direct sum of possibly many copies of OI as a bundle of P1. I mean, these are kind of fine dimensional mixed Hodge structures. These are vector bundles in the usual sense. I mean, fine, fine. So
when you say O of I, do you have a preferred
equivariant? No, in fact, that for O1 doesn't even exist. It has to be two copies. No, but this condition is just a condition, right? So for this, I forget this junk and just, just incoherent in vector bundles on P1. Okay, let me be in much more extent. I mean, it's not so difficult to see why this is true, because the usual definition of a Hodge structure is something which has a Hodge filtration and the real structure, two crucial ingredients. So a filtered object, there's this Ries construction, which from a filtered object, you can consider graded object over polynomials in one variable. And this is the same as GN equivariant sheaves on A1. So this is basically a filtered object. GN equivariant sheaf on A1 is just a filtered object. And so you take this guy, then you take the complex conjugate, and then you have the glue. But when you restrict to GM, this corresponds to forgetting the filtration. So you have some filtered guy, and you have an isomorphism between this guy and this complex conjugate that does not necessarily respect the filtration. And that's basically the Hodge structure. And then there are conditions, of course, but the conditions, you write down what they are, and they turn out to be this. But let me do this explicitly in the simplest possible example, which is the only one relevant to me today. So let's take something weight 1, pure weight 1, and then the only non-trivial Hodge numbers are H. 1, 0 and H01. The rest are H. So this is something which occurs on the first cohomology or something, right? So in this case the normal definition is what? So we have some, it's a usual definition. We have some real vector space UR. We have some complex vector space with a filtration, increasing filtration. And then we have this, in this interpretation, this gluing map, but in general, it's just an isomorphism between, say, alpha from the complexification of this guy to the underlying complex vector space of this guy. So one thing has a real structure, another thing has a filtration, they are isomorphic if you forget both. And since I require this, effectively what I have is that VC is actually just one of VC plus the complex conjugate with respect to this isomorphism. And this is the usual Hodge decomposition. Now, one thing which is very useful for Hodge structures is polarizations. So quite often you want to consider polarization, I also want to do this. Let me remind you what the definition here. And so the definition here is that, I mean, formal definition for weight one is just a pairing, which is in this case Q-symmetric and respects the Hodge structure. So it's some map omega from lambda 2 of V. Twisted by 2, to 1, 1, yes. 2 just the trigger Hodge structure, degree 0. Equivalently, we might just take some real symplectic form here. Such that when you apply alpha, you get something which is a filtered degree 1 in the set of filtration. 1 because of this. A priori it could be 0, but we want it to be 1. The condition. And then we can be even more explicit about it. So let me denote by M the quotient of this guy by this F1. Then of course, I mean, this projects to M, and if you apply alpha, then VR also maps to M, but VR is real, so it also maps to M bar. And so we have alpha plus alpha bar from VR to M plus M bar, which is an isomorphism. So roughly speaking, the data we have is the following. So we have M, just a complex vector space. We have M plus M bar projects here. And then we have some VC, which projects here. So there is a isomorphism alpha. So this VC is non-canonically isomorphic to M plus M dual because of this polarization. But I don't want to say, I mean, I can choose a splitting of the filtration, but I don't want to actually choose the splitting, so this is actually a torsor with respect to M star. So for a vector space, you have a certain extension of this vector space by the dual. And on the other hand, you have just its complexification, and then there is a map. Okay, this is almost completely empty. I'm just taking linear algebra and moving this around. And the point of doing this is that this picture, surprisingly, has no linear counterpart. You can now take M, instead of considering vector space, allow it to be a neighborhood of the point, I mean, consider it as actually a complex variety. So how do we do this? Let me first do the global case.
non-linear rush. So we have some kind of complex manifold. Equipped with a real analytic Keller form. The form, of course, has a cohomology class. It is global, so it could have a real cohomology. In H1, let me write this like this. So this is, of course, what classifies torsors over M with respect to this vector bundle. So it defines what they call a twisted cotangent bundle. So we have twisted cotangent. Turns out that you can now try to use this as a torsor and do a picture. So the picture would be like this. That is our M. This is the twist cotangent bundle. There is M. Cross M bar, which projects. And we can ask whether you actually can find a map, which would be an isomorphism that would make a diagonal connection. This is probably too strong, but what you can also do, you can consider, so here we have the diagonal. It's not an algebraic or complex submanifold, but since I'm topological, so this is just some kind of, you know, closed, totally real submanifold with complex manifold. And it's a standard fact of life is that it has a small Stein neighborhood, which is called the complexification of M. In fact, when you look at how Graur defined real analytic function on complex manifold, this is basically by definition complex analytic function of this neighborhood diagonal here. So we denote by Z this complexification. And you could ask for a map alpha, which is not a diagram commute. So what are the conditions of such an alpha? Would be an example. So what is such an alpha? How do you see what this is? So what is alpha? It's actually easy to see because so let me write the alpha. Alpha is a real analytic section of this torsor. Such that T bar alpha is equal to 1. What do I mean by this? Let's look at this locally on M so that the torsor can be trivialized. Trivialize it. Then, like maps from here to here would be just, you know, holomorphic forms. This would be just cotangent bundle, this would be holomorphic forms. We don't want that. We want a map from a section of the pullback of our omega from M to Z. But by definition, complex functions on Z are the same as real functions on M. So this would be just clearly just a 1-0 form of real analytic coefficients on the same M, just by definition. And so So the condition that this map would be an isomorphism. You can check it, I mean, this is just a, like a germ near the diagonal, so you can check it at every point of the diagonal, you compute the differential, and then the condition is that d bar alpha is some form, non-degenerate, which a posteriori represents the cohomology class. So this is the global picture, but locally, what you end up with is that diagrams like this are basically in one-to-one correspondences with the choice of actual color forms, not just classes, but actual color forms. And of course, if you have a color potential, then this alpha is just u psi. So this alpha is very close to the potential. And if I have a formula for alpha, it's easy to transport it back to the formula for the psi. Okay. We can go geometric on this if we want. So we can interpret this as a gluing diagram of things over P1, where this is the kind of the fiber over the intersection of the two charts, and this is the fiber over one of the charts. So geometrically, we can glue some X, which will be fiber over P1. We'll actually glue out of this twisted tangent thing. It's a complex conjugate. And then the intersection will be the Z. So this will be I should probably not go too global, so this is actually not, I mean, I should replace this with the image. This is an open embedding anyway, so I should just. And for those who know, this will be the twister space of the canonical hypercolor metric on T-star L. That's not important today. It's the twister space. Let me now take my attention to the situation where M is purely local. So it's just a neighborhood of a point, a formal neighborhood of a point. So now, it becomes basically the same thing as the diagram here, but you have to reinterpret the maps. So these were just linear maps between vector spaces. Here you have maps between those vector spaces, but not necessarily linear. These are just considered as, you know, formal joint of neighborhoods of the unity, so they have two formal varieties and a map between varieties. Of course, we know that there is a name for that. It's called an L-infinity map between abelian Lie algebras. There is the leading term, which is the differential, but then there are all sorts of higher L-infinity corrections. And the point is that this is exactly this, where alpha is an L-infinity map. So we have a bench action. Between Keller matrix. And diagrams like this. Where alpha is a little infinity map. Between, so these are abelian the algebras, so there is no bracket, no higher structures, but there are correction terms. And exactly these L infinity terms are more or less literally given to this alpha and then Keller potential rest. Okay, so this was a long detour. Now we can go back to our original problem. So as you see, if you want to see this metric in any explicit way, what you need to see some kind of non-trivial L infinity map, which comes up in the deformation theorem. So how does it work? Back to our case. So in our case, this M is just the deformations, normal deformation space of some stable vector bundle in the curve. And then we have this A. Which is a infinity algebra in mixed Hodge structures. But then, with this geometric interpretation, we can treat this as actually two things. So there's the middle part, which is just an infinity algebra with a real structure, just an infinity algebra with reals. And then there is the part corresponding to chart. And this is the filtered A infinity algebra over C. And then there is this Gluon isomorphism. And the claim is that both of the L infinity algebras can be easily seen to be, in this case, actually trivial, abelian. But you can't claim that about the isomorphism. In fact, it's not true. And the isomorphism is the essential kind of the core of the situation. So why is this? Of course, here, I mean, this is a flat bundle on the curve. We can choose a harmonic representative. So we have the harmonic projection. Let me denote it by P. It's a projection from the whole thing. I won't write this. Onto itself, squares to the identity. This is just a projection on the harmonic forms. So it squares to the identity, and on the other hand, identity minus p is chain homotopic to zero. I'm not claiming that this respects any of the multiplication or whatever, it doesn't. It's just a kind of it's a chain level thing. It just exists on the level of complexes. So this is chain homotopic to zero, but in two different ways. So you can choose a homotopy that respects the real structure, or you can choose the homotopy which respects the Hodge filtration. But you cannot have both at the same time. Different ways. It's easy to write down the homotopies just in terms of the Green operator, but then in one formula you use basically straight D star, and the other you use curly D star. So very different. Then, of course, when you have such a situation, so you have some kind of Dirichlet algebra and the projection onto its cohomology, such that this is homotopic to zero. There is the standard homotopy transfer formula, which gives you an induced Dirichlet algebra structural cohomology and some kind of infinity. In this case, the structural cohomology will be completely trivial, but there will be some L infinity map. And so plugging these two different homotopies into the homotopy transfer formula, we get the following. So write homotopy transfer. We have, so there is the original guy. And then there are, so as I said, one respects the filtration, the other respects the complex structure. So here we have just H1, but we forget about H2, and I can say go to traceless part and then it'll just disappear. So here we have H1, there are X coefficients. And here you have so basically the sum of the two Hodge terms. So it's Y1 X coefficients this plus the dual thing. Like fields or whatever. Now, both of these are completely trivial algebras, but there are some kind of possible non-trivial infinity maps, and then their composition. They're both isomorphisms, so you can invert them. And then this is our alpha. So that's how I'm going to actually formula. No, I didn't write down the formula because I decided to do this. But it shouldn't be that difficult because the homotopy transfer, what you get is basically sum of trees over trees. So there's some kind of sum over trees. Here you just have to do this two times and then write down the composition. It doesn't look like such a difficult task. And then you will get a formula which will give you all the coefficients of the Keller potential as some kind of sum over trees. And it would be kind of interesting to try to compare it to what you get from determinants, to maybe understand what's the meaning of those determinants, because... Well, I did, so I looked at the original paper by Quillen, which is actually in Russian. It's like 4 pages paper in functional analysis, it's actually in Russian. And I thought, great, I mean, Quillen, 3 pages, I should be able to read it. Now, apparently what happened is that you get the impression he didn't write this. You get the impression that he was giving a talk and somebody took notes. And that somebody was not quite into the subject, which was very new at that time. In particular, he never mentions the need for the Remission Young-Mills connection, which...
He never mentions what?
I mean, you know, what I presented to you in definition of Petterson metric, you have to choose an Remission metric on E, which is like a Remission Young-Mills.
Yes.
Which is like a zero of the moment map. Mm-hmm. So it's not mentioned there at all. Take some. I mean, he never claims anything in the paper which is wrong. Everything there is formally correct, but... I mean, this was a very long time, but this was before Kempfness, I think, so... The upshot. There is a formula in terms of zeta value, and it's very easy to... Well, reasonably easy, I mean, it's like two-line formula, to compute the second derivative to see that this is omega. But if you want to compute only the third derivative, it's not so easy. Because what happens, you have some kind of, like, Dirac operator or whatever, power s, then you take several derivatives, and then you want to move them around. But the problem is that the derivative of the operator does not commute to the operator, of course. In the end, you take trace, which should kind of somehow cancel out. But there should be some kind of explicit formula in terms of this. No, I'm not very good at guessing the formulas. But here is a formal procedure which gives you a formula on the nose. There is not, you don't have to think here at all. And then maybe it would explain what happens there. Okay, a couple more remarks. So this was for curves, right? But in fact, generalization to high-dimensional varieties is also immediate. So for higher dimensional x, so basically you start with the same assumptions. You take E, which is stable or polystable, stable, which means it has this Hermitian-Young-Wells connection. So Hermitian-Young-Wells metric and connection, which I remind you means that the curvature, some map from some two forms, but then when you apply this Lefschetz lambda, which is kind of bearing that, so this is also Keller, so it has a Keller form, so there's this bearing with omega, and this should be a constant times the identity. This means that when you take endomorphisms, you also get the connection, but there the constant is zero. So it's not really flat, but the curvature is concentrated in a part which is annihilated by this lambda. And so you want to write down something like A dirac. So A dirac you cannot write anymore because it's not flat. But there is an obvious replacement for this, which is as follows. So you start with dome wall. And we'll write this 0, 2. Then there is the conjugate of dome wall. And then you add one more term here. So this goes on all the way. And there is one more term, the rest is killed off. So there is, so this is basically A 0, 0 again. But the map is the usual differential to A 1, 1. But then you compose the lambda, which is a projection for A 0, 0. So this is a certain quotient of a complex which doesn't exist, but this is okay, because when you do this, this squares to zero because of this. Basically take out, you consider the usual, so forget the differentials, consider the just the usual complex of forms, take out everything generated by things annihilated by lambda, and then the rest has a well-defined differential. You might ask why is this elliptic? You can rewrite it in a way which makes it obvious, so you can write a quasi-dimensional complex. So what you can do, you can spread this out. You take just the whole, then conjugate, and then you have one, two copies of this. So you have A0, and then the differentials here are just identity. Here, it's what I have here, it's basically lambda composed with del bar and lambda composed with del. And here it's something like lambda composed with del del bar. And this clearly elliptic. And that's quite dimorphic to this. And then you play the same game, so this is also kind of a huge, especially, I mean, this one especially is obviously a huge algebra in mixed Hodge structure. It has that integration in degree 2, which gives you the leading term, and then so it kind of works. This uses crucially the Hermitian-Young-Wells metric. So I don't know how to get out without it. And one curious observation is that in this setting you have some kind of Keller manifold, and you look at various, you know, coherent sheaves, and you want to have a Keller metric on the modular space. So of course you get one on modular space of stable bundles. There is one obvious example where you also get it, namely modular space of points of skyscraper sheaves, which is certainly not stable. I don't know whether you can make a version of this conception for that, but the answer is obviously there, but there is a catch. So for the stable case, I said Kenner metric, but I only basically used this cohomology class. That was really not dependent on the metric itself. Whereas for skyscrapers, it depends on the metric itself. And metric can be very bad. It doesn't have to be real analytic or whatever. It can be anything. So I'm really lost at what is the proper generality of the whole story. So you could formally now axiomatize, answer my original question by saying that you have a DG algebra, you add a complex conjugate, and then you want the whole thing to be a DG algebra. Well, maybe DG algebra in least Hodge structures, I mean, some things like that. But what Mailach can get out of it in what situation is not clear to me at all. But at least when you have some stability, I think this should work. And maybe it will be a reasonable notion to consider. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
So if I didn't start with a stable bundle, or I started with something that had some number of automorphisms, is there some equivariant version of the story you've outlined here?
Well, yes, modulo that you, it's not clear what you want to get, because as I said in the beginning, at least to me, it's completely unclear what's the conceptually correct notion of a metric on a stack. So if you have something which is just polystable, that should be trivial, I mean, polystable, reductive automorphism, doesn't matter. But in monotrivial situation, I'm not sure what you... You could probably get what you want, but it's not clear what you want.
Okay, so in principle, kind of metric is some degree of the Riemann-Rochte. It's a local version of the Riemann-Rochte. In higher dimensions, if you do the same thing, you could do Riemann-Rochte for higher dimensional parameters.
Yeah, yeah. Right?
So it would be formal for this, would involve some channel classes.
Yeah.
A priori, it doesn't have to be positive. It doesn't have to be a kind of metric if you sort of integrate it in such a way.
No, that's of course also true. No, that I absolutely have no comment about. It's something you absolutely, it's probably important. But one remark is that you can look at this higher, like people by Bismuth and other people.
Yes, that's what all those people do. Yes,
yeah, but the problem doesn't help at all, because they develop the story in kind of a different direction. So what you get here is kind of the two form, and then they add corrections of higher order to this, but still just every higher form would only have the leading term. Here you are happy with the two form, but you want the higher derivative explicitly. But the, so it's kind of different direction to develop a story. But the positivity should be very important. And it probably only makes sense under some assumptions on DG algebra, some kind of stability conditions. You probably should go in pair of some kind of construction which is more, so this is like a metric construction, but there should be some kind of topological core where you put a metric on. And then you probably want this.
Other questions? Not let's think that you know again.